get it on. Got to get it on. No choice but to get it on. And I want to welcome back to the podcast two of my favorites, Teresa Strasser and Bald Brian. Now, last time we spoke to Teresa, it was without Bald Brian because Bald Brian was enjoying his honeymoon.
Yes.
Back from Maui.
I was attempting to enjoy a honeymoon. The reason I wasn't here was because the first couple of days were rough. We were in Maui, and they lost my luggage on day one, and I got sick on day two. So we decided, let's look into extending the honeymoon to a couple of days, and we did, and hence why I was there for a couple extra days.
Uh-huh. And the lost luggage thing, it feels like a vestige and a punchline from the past, but they still do it these days.
Yeah, you're sitting around the carousel, and there's nothing coming out. And the people come up to you, they're like, oh, your luggage should be coming on the next flight. And you're like, oh, all right. Should be? And
should be.
Yeah, should be. It turns out the next two flights. So you, and you're calling constantly. You're like, where's my luggage? Where's my luggage? Like, oh, it's somewhere in SFO. And you're like, oh, well, how long is your luggage out here? And they say, we don't know, but it'll be on another, a later flight. So
right.
The flight ends up being next day at 2 in the afternoon.
Well, this is where my ploy of wearing the exact same thing 4 days in a row when I go on a vacation, no matter where I go, really pays dividends.
Right.
The copious amounts of ball powder I dump down my shorts so I can wear the same midway briefs. I mean, Donnie and I went through Europe. I wore the same midways. I got 8 days out of same pair of midways, at least same pair of pants, same thing. What I realize, though, is stay away from the dacrons and the rayons and the polyesters.
Yep.
And I actually had a moment where I was smelling. I had one of these sort of polyester workout shirts, like sort of Under Armour-y or whatever. You know the sort of workout shirts that are sort of made of, I don't know what, that dries quickly or whatever it was?
It wicks away moisture.
Wicks away the moisture.
Yeah, some kind of man-made polymer.
Yes, and I was noticing for one of the first times in a long time some funk coming from my armpit, and then I realized, you know what? I shouldn't blame the foreigners for smelling so much. It's not them.
It's their fiber.
It's their fiber.
Yeah.
They're attracted to the man-made polymers. They don't wear the 100% cotton like we do. Every day laborer I've ever worked with wore a dress shirt, essentially something from the 70s that Tony Manero would have worn in, you know, Dance Fever. And yet, that's where the funk. Anyone who's listening, put one of these shirts on and go out. And it's the idea of rayon, dacron, polyester meets disco. Is the world meets cocaine.
Right.
It's the world's worst fucking
meets
combination of fun.
A small, crowded space
right.
Where you're dancing.
So you take this man-made fiber, do a little bump of the little Bolivian marching powder, then go out on the packed dance floor and get your robot on for 3 hours, and then we'll come home and make sweet love. You're going to fucking stink like
hell.
Well,
that's why they wore so much cologne in that era.
You had to.
They had to.
You had to. So, Brian, how's your health? Where are we in your treatment and catch everyone up on it?
Treatment is done. I've been done. Well, radiation is done. I've been done for a couple of weeks. My 6 weeks is over. I've been out of it for about 4 weeks. My symptoms, they feel worse sometimes than ever. Like, it's weird. I feel more tired now than I did in week number two.
Mm-hmm.
But they just tell me, I went in for my first MRI, and they tell me that it looks normal. About the same size tumor, but that's to be expected. They hope the radiation will continue to shrink it over the course of a few months and years. And I'm back on chemo for 5 days at a time, starting yesterday. So 5 days chemo, then off for a month, then on for 5 days.
So you had your first MRI.
Right.
And they said it's normal.
Yeah, they said it's what they expected.
And the idea is to stop, I mean, number one, stop the tumor from growing by hitting it with the chemo and the radiation.
Yep.
And then hopefully shrink it.
Yeah, they retard its growth, and then they shrink it.
Right, exactly. So they've hopefully stopped the growth, and over the course of the next few MRIs, which usually they want to schedule them every couple of months, they will look for a shrinkage, a reduction in the size of the actual tumor.
How do they physically calculate that?
I don't know. I mean, like, how do they... Like,
they put you in the exact same position and take a picture and literally measure the picture or hold it up to one another, use it as a, you know, put it over the other one,
I guess they can tell how relatively big it is compared to the rest of my brain or the actual size of the actual the scan. The one they use now, they call it a baseline measurement. They'll use this one as the baseline measurement to compare all others against, so they'll know how much it shrunk.
So that baseline picture was probably taken before your first radiation.
Right. And there's not, that one's not as good. So they used it to kind of like discard it a little bit. The one they took a couple days ago or a couple weeks ago is the new baseline, which they'll use to measure the progress.
That's basically Kirstie Alley before the Jenny Craig.
Yes, the Cheers right. era. Yeah.
No, not the Cheers era. That's the bloated Kirstie Alley.
Oh.
And Cheers then they, era and then was, they, she was looking pretty
she
good.
She looked good in the Cheers era. Oh, that, okay. That's the fat before picture.
Yes.
And then we use that to monitor the progress as the pounds melt off.
Yeah. Right now, my Kirstie Alley / tumor will look...
I'm sure she'll love that.
Will look...
that's the best role she's gotten in years.
That's right. It'll appear to be worse in some instances, but a trained doctor can look at it and say, well, this is better.
Because it's been aggravated, so to speak,
exactly.
by the pressure that's been put on it via the radiation.
And you said that some of your symptoms now feel worse. Which are the hardest?
My left arm and leg are clumsy, and more so than they were, like I said, in weeks 1, 2, and 3. And as a result, like walking around and like just trying to walk normally can be a little bit of a challenge. So luckily, Chrissy, my wife, usually I say fiance, but now I say wife. Chrissy, my wife, is really helpful with just... It's really, really unbelievable to help me get it around. And she's documenting this whole thing at incommunitytumor.com.
Their excellent blog.
Her excellent blog.
Here's what a great guy you are. When I had my fiance, Lynette, go from fiance to wife, I called her my girlfriend for the first 6 months. I went the other direction. She got a demotion. And now I call her my fiance.
Can I say something cheesy, though? So now it's been a year since I've been married, and if I hear my husband on the phone and he refers to me as his wife, I feel like crying.
Really? Mm.
Yeah.
It's
I
emotional.
Still love it. Isn't that embarrassing?
Like a what have I done kind of cry?
No. Like I just can't believe he's referring to me.
No?
I know. Something about
sweet.
It.
That's
nice.
So
yeah.
when he says ball and chain, you hear wife.
Yeah, exactly.
Or when he thinks ball and chain, he says wife.
Well, that's he says good. Albatross, I hear
yeah,
wife.
The old witch.
So
that's the whole reason for me to get married, because girlfriend and fiance are such lame terms.
Yeah, I concur. So Brian had the MRI how long ago?
I think the day I got back on Wednesday.
And they were positive about it.
They're overall. I mean, a great MRI would have been, you know, hey, this thing's going away. But they saw some great things on there, which is the tumor's the same size. There's no growth. And the radiation's working, and keep up.
And they know the radiation is working because it's not grown.
I asked the doctor the same thing. I said, how do you know the radiation worked? He looks at me and says, the radiation always works. So
I wonder that, too, because, you know, here you probably had that tumor a long time before you were aware that it
probably.
Was there. So how can you tell if it's fast growing or slow growing?
Yeah, they don't know. They would have to biopsy it to really tell. But as the doctors say, we've seen enough of these to know what's what. And to get really into it. The new scans are different than the old scans, and that the MRI, and that the new scans show some minor enhancement in the actual like area of the tumor, but that's how that kind of tumor responds to treatment. You know, you want that. You want
so they know it knows it's being treated.
Yeah, exactly. And they say it's acting like a low grade, slow growing, you know, tumor. So
and these enhancements are what are causing your symptoms.
Yeah, exactly. Minor symptoms too, like. I say like I'm slurring a lot, but it's just my tongue and my lips are kind of numb on one side, and it sucks, but, you know, it's getting better.
Well, the wedding was beautiful, and I'm glad you guys were able to add a couple of days to your honeymoon. And, Teresa, now you have a condition as well. There's a tumor growing in your belly.
It's
got a name on it.
Yeah, well, he doesn't have a name yet, but we've just started calling him Buster. That will not be his name. It's just his little fetal nickname.
Due date is what again?
October 2nd. And I just realized, I don't know why, sometimes I figure things out very late. Like, I think it was 2 weeks ago when I realized that the G in Gmail stood for Google. That's something a second grader should know. Did you know that?
No. I mean, to be fair to me, I've never thought about it. But there are things that just sort of logos and things that dawn on me after a while. Like, that's 2 M's. Yeah, that's the name of the company.
There's the FedEx logo.
This happened to me when I realized that you're not really pregnant for 9 months. Mm-hmm. You're pregnant for 40 weeks.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like almost 10 months.
Right.
And I got kind of upset. I was like, sure. I'm 7 months into this. I thought I couldn't figure out, like, why do I keep being 6 months pregnant forever?
Right.
And then I realized it's a little longer. But
you feel like you got time tacked on your sentence?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I really do. I was like, this is a sham. My whole life I've been told you're pregnant.
Who do I complain to about this?
Who do I go to? But I mean, all in all, I can't complain because it's been, even though I've had a few little, you know, things, it's been a pretty great pregnancy. Although the last week, as I was just telling you guys about seeing that awful My Sister's Keeper movie, I just had this weird...
Off
like,
the air, you were telling
yeah,
us
Yeah, I was telling you guys
that.
Off the air. Mm-hmm. That
what was awful about it?
Well, here's the weird thing. It wasn't an awful movie, but I think it... I had a week where I was just really down. I just wake up every day. I'd wake up and start crying, and then mm-hmm. I'd cry for about 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And then pack up...
By the way, when you're having those kinds of weeks, you're supposed to rent Mad, Mad, Mad World. Not My Sister's Keeper, well, or Brian's Song, or list. Terms of Endearment.
I think My Sister's Keeper... I couldn't figure out what was different, because all along since I've been pregnant, I've had, like, you know, worries and fears and stuff, but I've been pretty okay emotionally.
Mm-hmm.
And I had this one week where I just felt like really down. In fact, the last time I was here, I think was right around there, and I got a bunch of emails from people. Are you okay? But I try to trace it back. Like, what happened? Because I felt fine. I realized that seeing that movie may have triggered some weird depression, because it was so sad. And it wasn't like an awful movie. It was okay. But I started crying about 10 minutes into it. Mm-hmm. And then, like, my whole sleeve was drenched because I was trying to... Then I was crying so hard, I was having trouble breathing. It was mm-hmm. embarrassing.
Mm-hmm.
And my husband was looking at me, kind of laughing at me.
Mm-hmm. I was the same way yesterday at Transformers 2.
Did it disappoint?
Drenched in tears. It didn't disappoint, but it wasn't that good.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
Sorry, I didn't interrupt your story.
Well, to wrap it up. So, I've never cried that much in a movie. I mean, right. It's just... It's about the kid with cancer, for God's sakes. Then she gets a boyfriend, and he's got cancer. I just couldn't take it.
Right.
It was so relentless. And the music.
Eventually, the sound guy and the first AD gets cancer. Then the guy, everyone on the set, craft service, everyone gets cancer.
Eventually, everyone, and then it was like Hamlet. Everyone, and it was, I really couldn't catch my breath during the
right.
movie. And my friend Ben Mankiewicz reviewed it on Apple
sure.
Movies, and he made the point that the music is really literal. So the songs are like, she's 12, she has cancer,
yep.
goodbye.
So
the whole thing was just too much. And the next day when I woke up, my body couldn't differentiate whether that had happened to me
mm-hmm.
or to the actors. Like, I felt like I'd been to a funeral.
Well, I mean, if you think about the way the human mind and the psyche works, you know, like, you ever have that dream where something bad happens or something good happens, and you wake up the next day, and you wake up, and 2 seconds after you wake up, you realize that didn't just happen, but you sort of walk around with that feeling? Like, you ever have those sex dreams where you've had sex with somebody who you work with, and then you show up that morning at work, and there's that person? And there's a whole part of your brain that absolutely knows I did not have sex
right.
with this person. But there's this little kernel inside your brain that gives a, how you doing? And or who thinks somehow they know, they're going to know or whatever.
If you have something to say to Chaffee.
You feel, thank you. I'm so glad I could broach you. So the point is you get these little things and you carry them around, and your brain has a sort of dimmer switch on it, but it's not a toggle switch. You can't just shut stuff off. And so if you're going to go to a movie and you're going to be moved by the movie, you're not going to walk out of the theater and completely leave it behind. If it's a funny movie, you'll sort of be laughing on the way home, or you'll be thinking about those things. I've always said that I think about the worst thing you could say about a movie is that you leave the movie theater and it's sort of like, huh? Like, what'd you guys talk about on the way to the restaurant? Not the movie. You know,
yeah,
it's completely gone. And the best thing you can say about it is it sort of stayed with you for a number of days. And I would say the greatest compliment you could pay someone like Oliver Stone, who makes a lot of really good movies and he's made a few duds, his movies, like when you watch The Doors, the next day you'll be thinking about Jim Morrison.
The mood stays with you.
Yeah, the mood will be with you. You'll feel like you were high.
Yeah.
And the next day you'll go, I want to listen to my, you'll dust off that Doors album and you'll put it on, or you'll grab a book that Robbie Krieger wrote and want to read it. Like, it'll get you there. Good movie, bad movie, long movie, short movie, boring movie, exciting movie. Just whatever it is, the idea that the next day it's on your mind.
Yeah,
you find your mind going there.
I remember seeing Dead Man Walking, and for, I don't know why, but for some reason I felt like I needed bereavement counseling. I couldn't, I was so upset that Sean Penn had never had shrimp until his last meal. I couldn't let go. Okay. I remember walking to the coffee shop afterwards, and the person working there said, did you just leave Dead Man Walking?
Well,
they could tell.
They knew.
Your eyes. It was in my eyes. Yeah, but for just physiologically, my face was so puffy from crying, and my eyes hurt, and my body just thought, we must be sad. Like, something bad's happened.
Yeah. Same thing with me in Disorderlies.
Yes. The Fab Boys.
I just could never. I wasn't right.
I understand.
I would go to work the next day, and people are like, "Adam, hello, wake up!" And I'm like, "Huh?"
Was Pauly Shore in that?
No, the Fat Boys.
It was the Fat Boys. They were fat, black disorderlies. They were orderlies at the hospital.
They couldn't do anything right. Hilarity ensued.
Well, when you get 600-pound black guys pushing a gurney with a spindly old white woman on it, that movie's going to write itself.
Yep.
Do you have a Skype call, by the way, Donald, or and or Chaffee?
Yes,
can
we
do. Can I briefly say before we do that, speaking of things that made me cry, what about Brian's wedding, first dance?
Yeah.
First he Rickrolls us.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to ask your reaction to that.
He Rickrolled us. Yeah.
First he Rickrolls us. Then he busts out the Heaven.
Oh.
The Bryan Adams version.
I was so pleased.
Yeah.
Me and Lynette were a mess.
It was wonderful. And it was touching. I mean, if I wasn't at the bar, I feel like I would have really been moved by that first dance. He Rickrolled us. Yeah, I'm sorry, Chaffee.
Yeah, we got Eric on the line. He's got a boxing question for you guys.
Let's put our headphones on and see what happens. Hello?
Hey, Adam, what's up, buddy?
Eric?
Yes, sir, what's going on?
How goes it?
Oh, it's great, man. I can't tell you what an honor it is. I've been listening to you for like 9 years now, and I've started a little thing at school. I go to college, and I got when you came out with your best of podcast, I made like 50 copies of them, just handed them out to random kids, and trying to do my part, brother.
Thank you very much, Eric. Appreciate you spreading the word.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask you like about the state of boxing in general and how you feel about Arturo Gatti's passing.
Arturo Gatti was choked out by his wife using her purse, and Arturo Gatti is... he was a champion.
Like choked out of life? Like choked out of this earth?
Yes.
Oh.
Yes. He, Arturo Gatti had the epic wars with Mickey Ward, if you want to see some of the great fights ever. Arturo Gatti is one of these guys that had four fights, like Ring Magazine Fight of the Year. Like every year, you know, the most action-packed fight gets Fight of the Year. The idea that you have one of those in your career is a pretty good milestone. He had four in his career. So he was an action-packed guy. Long on heart, not the most ability in the world, probably ended up finishing at like 40-7 or something like that. But had a younger wife, maybe a second wife, was on vacation with her, and got into an argument, went back to the hotel. I'm assuming he was drunk. I'm assuming he was passed out. And I believe she choked him out with her purse and killed him. It's a crazy thing because, you know, not only did McNair go, you know, a couple of weeks back at the age of, I think, 36, 36, 37.
Shot by his girlfriend and then shot herself.
Yeah. But Gotti also got it, too. I think he was 37. He retired a couple of years ago, retired in 07. Huh. And it's insane, obviously, that a guy who was that a crazy warrior in the ring would go getting choked out by his old lady and her purse.
Strings.
Eric?
Yes, sir.
The thing about boxing, the heavyweight division is sort of dead. I've been saying for some time that what really should happen is the two Klitschkos should get together.
Oh, and yeah, that'll never happen, but that would be one heck of a fight if they would ever do it.
Well, they do this thing where it's like, ah, I can't beat you up, you're my brother. Don't most brothers grow up beating the crap out of each other?
Yeah.
Brother. I had a sister and we beat the crap out of each other. I would gladly fight her for $20 million.
I mean, but what ounce gloves?
I go Reyes, because I'm a puncher and it's a puncher's glove. It's a Mexican glove. And I go Liza and Goga, 8 ounce Reyes. And that's the terms. So, you know, here's the thing, and you guys tell me what you think of this. I have said that these two, although if they don't do it in the next year or so, my theory will be shit on. These Klitschkos, these two giant Russian by way of Germany brothers who are the cream of the crop in the heavyweight division, won't fight each other because they're brothers. But imagine it would be the biggest fight of all time. I mean, it would be brother against brother. They would call it, you know, blood war, next of kin, whatever it would be. They could both get $40 million for this fight. Now, them fighting tomato can du jour, which was my name when I fought.
Hard to fit that on the back of a row.
Well, it was my poor name, too.
You fought France.
That, you know, that's good, but that doesn't get them this nutty. I mean, if these two brothers, the two Klitschkos, it would dominate John and Kate plus 8. Move over.
Please.
These would be the biggest news. Jacko, move over. This would dominate. Everyone would be talking about. People would be arguing. Is it good? They could give half the proceeds to the Big Brother program or Little Brother program or whatever it is. I don't know what's going on in the heavyweight division's a little boring. Pacquiao getting together with Floyd Mayweather is probably going to be the fight that everyone's looking for.
I think that's going to be bigger than the Klitschko's fight because they have more recognizability in America, you know.
The Klitschko fight, if the Klitschkos ever got together, would just be huge on a level that sort of transcended boxing.
Right. I mean, it's a big deal when Venus and Serena play each other.
Right. And they're not beating the crap out of each other with
their
fists.
That'd be more entertaining.
I would definitely watch that fight. Definitely watch that fight. Thanks, Eric.
Thanks, Adam. Take care, buddy.
Appreciate it, brother. You have another Skype call for us?
Yeah, we do. We got a question for Brian from Ted.
You say Ted?
Hey, Brian.
Hello, Ted.
Hey, Brian. How you doing?
Good, man. How are you?
Hey, so did you get the Transformers wall art?
I did. Was that courtesy of you?
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, so, it's going up soon.
Yeah, the real question is, now that you're married, does Chrissy let you hang it up?
She wanted to put it up first.
Really?
Yeah.
So you got Ted sent it?
They're fathead posters, right?
Fathead.
Yeah, yeah. Big 4 foot wall poster, you know, nice nerd thing for Brian.
They're awesome.
So you got Ted, you got Brian the fathead posters.
Of Optimus and of Bumblebee.
And are they're 6 foot tall?
4 foot tall.
4 foot tall.
Now, was Megan Fox as hot in this movie as everyone is saying?
Yes. Michael Bay, for better or worse, the director really knows how to shoot a good-looking lady. I mean, he really shoots the movie well.
And they featured her and her assets.
Yes.
And the fathead just goes up on the wall. I've seen the commercials. You just roll it right up on the wall and begin masturbating.
In whatever order you want, you stay right on the wall.
Right.
Yeah.
All right.
Does it clean up well?
We'll hope so. Hopefully it's Scotch Garden.
Are you telling me, Ted, that you did not laminate?
I did not laminate, but, you know,
they,
I guess
they
I
come
sure
that
know
way,
Brian.
I believe. And so, yeah. Ted, you sent this as a gift to Brian?
I did.
I just got it, by the way. I called it. Thank you, Ted.
Yeah, I figured it came when you guys were all off at the wedding, but, you know, whatever.
It just picked it up a couple days ago. It's awesome.
Ted, thank you. It was very generous of you.
Yeah,
hey, no problem. And hey, T and Adam. Talk to you guys later.
Thank you.
Bye.
Oh, no fathead for the ace, man.
Yeah.
I guess they don't make John Hine a fathead.
That's right.
I hadn't heard of the fat boys or the fathead till
now. Really?
So that fathead email.
Fathead's a sports thing that sort of started off with, and by the way, the kids today, you know, we had the poster Farrah Fawcett or whatever. These are just full size. You know, they started off with, you know, Albert Pujols and Brian Urlacher and the Manning brothers, but they've now expanded into, you know, NASCAR. When they get into porn, tell me.
Oh, God.
I'll show you a fathead.
Awesome strong.
Now they just do everything, and they're sort of, they just peel off and stick on your wall, but it's like static or something, so you can just sort of whip it off and go move it
like
to the next place.
No, you know, thumbtacks.
No.
No thumbtacks, and no, like, oh, the next guy who moves in the apartment has to paint over the ghost of Optimus Prime, who is stuck to the wall. it doesn't, I don't believe there's adhesives involved.
I didn't peel off yet, so we'll find out.
All right, so anyway, you can put all...
Did you say peel one off?
I did peel one off. I haven't peeled it off yet.
Yeah, it's a cool business. I guess they just license. Obviously, you have to license with these companies, and then you get Kobe Bryant or Spider-Man or whoever up on your wall.
A brief note on porn. Last time I was here, we talked about the Not the Brady Bunch porn, which was, Brian, I saw when I was at your wedding.
That's
in beautiful, classy Napa. We rented a hotel porn in Yountville, and a lot of people wrote to ask about it. I had no idea that it was a giant porn hit.
Well,
like, I think it was at one point the fastest selling porn DVD.
The Brady Bunch.
Yeah, and you mentioned that there was also Not Happy Days. There's also Star Trek parody.
Yeah, well, that came out before Star Trek even came out.
Partridge Family. They do all these now. They're very successful.
Yeah. Call me when they do Small Wonder, by the way. That's something I really feel like I can stick my teeth into.
Yeah.
Vicky the Robot.
Yeah.
That's right.
Vicky the Robot. All right, so...
can you imagine the nightmare that the Partridge Family one must be?
This ain't the Partridge Family or the Partridge Family. But apparently there is, you know, they cast the actors to look like...
Yeah, but...
There's a Bonaducci.
What? Yeah.
They couldn't get the real Bonaducci?
I feel like they could have.
Directed by...
Well, when you're doing a porn movie where half the cast is under 18... At what point? You know what I mean?
The casting is excellent. And I have to say, the people in the Not the Brady Bunch seem slightly less molested than your usual porn stars. Yeah.
Than the actual cast.
They look wholesome?
Yeah. And are you able to just rip off a title by putting Not in front of it?
Apparently.
Like, could I start a professional franchise and call it Not the Dallas Cowboys?
Not the Yankees.
Right. Not the Lakers.
Really?
I'm going to start a TV show, Not Mad Men.
Yeah. We should keep going with this. Yeah. So, I wasn't doing the Brady math where you have Cindy and Bobby and Greg and actually... All of them.
Yeah, except Sam the Butcher, who's played by Ron Jeremy.
Oh, really? And
he gives Alice the meat.
Oh, of course.
And Sam and Al. Well, so everyone is underage.
Yeah, you know, they somehow sort of keep it wholesome. Like, the first, there's a long time without a sex scene.
What?
And then you're in Marsha's bedroom, which the set looks like the Brady set. And then she has some adult toys under the bed.
Well, to be fair, all porn sets look like the Brady set.
They kind of do.
If you think about it, just bad 70s
bad rugs.
But so I don't get it in the whether you're doing the Partridge, like the Partridge Family. You're doing the Partridge Family porn. First off, which Chris, the drummer, do they use?
Good question.
You got to make a decision there. Use the Jewy kid or the Aryan kid. By the way, aren't you supposed to replace the kid with another kid that's sort of like that kid?
Go off it.
I guess they did
because they went with the just a Sephardic Jew to a guy who looked like he was in the Hitler Youth. And by the way, the beauty of TV is no mention of it. He's just a drummer. But Tracy and Chris, the drummer, I mean, Tracy and the Partridge Family could barely lift the tambourine. I mean, she was, you know, she was 6 and a half.
Right. And then in the porn version, lifting the tambourine becomes a euphemism for something horribly dirty.
I mean, does Tracy in the Partridge Family have sex?
Well, here's the thing. Cindy Brady in the Brady... I didn't watch long enough. I don't know if Cindy... I only made it halfway through, so I don't know if Cindy has a scene. Jan has a scene, but it's girl on girl.
Oh.
See, so that's
tasteful.
A little... Yeah, and Marsha just has a scene with herself, if you know what I'm saying.
Uh-huh. So you think they...
If a dildo's wholesome.
But how does one start a program by themselves? Oh.
So you think they thought about this? Like, they went like, look, there's no way we can have someone who's supposed to be playing a 9-year-old get nailed by Ron Jeremy, but she can go at herself with a double-ended dildo And that's within the bounds of good taste?
Or Jan, who, I don't know how old Jan's supposed to be.
I'm sure they're considering the bounds of good taste. Yeah. Sure, my mind.
Well, Jan's just experimenting with her girlfriend.
Uh-huh.
But, yeah, it's definitely
well,
right.
Jan would have been, when the show started, probably 9, and when the show finished, probably like 14.
That is kind of tacky now like that I think about it. Something tacky in a porn
setting. Yeah.
Inside, by the way, you only halfway through.
Yeah. Yeah. I know, so I don't know what really happened.
I don't, that's why I focus, I mean, my porn is never the family-oriented young sitcom. I go with the cop drama, like Hill Street Blues.
Oh, yeah.
Mannix.
Yep.
Things like that. You know, Beretta. That was a good porn.
Not Beretta.
Not Beretta.
Ironside. Sorry. Tough to watch.
Not Junior.
Compelling. Barnaby Jones, I don't recommend.
No.
That was a bad porn.
This isn't Cagney and Lacey.
81-year-old guy going at it. Barnaby Jones.
Not Quincy.
First guy that was going to have Barnaby take him down was the first guy to call him Pops. If you ever watch Barnaby Jones, I think it was Buddy Epson, but it's like some punk would be like, hey, Pops, you can't collar me. That was always meant he was going to get his ass kicked by an 80-year-old Buddy Epson. All right. What the hell else are we
not
talking about?
Not Golden Girls is not popular.
Any more Skype phone calls there, Chofster?
Yeah, we got Bradley on the line. He's got a question about cars.
Brad?
Yeah, Adam.
What's happening?
Hey, how you doing?
Good.
Hey, I just want to say thanks for making the podcast, and I'm turning all my friends on to it, so I really appreciate it.
Well, you know, I'm reclipping my mic on. I give this speech, I don't know, once a month or something like that. That is our reward would be ratings and seeing us up there amongst the leaders on iTunes and all that kind of stuff. And that's all we ask you guys to do. If you dig the show, spread it around.
Your fans are so amazing. Can I say, if I feel like everywhere I go, people ask me about the podcast, they mention the podcast, and I don't know if you've talked about this, but the Entertainment Weekly, have you discussed that on your podcast?
I'm sure I brought it
you
up.
You are on their must list?
Yeah.
Must podcast?
Yeah.
I think I brought it.
Well, to be fair, they sort of did it like the Brady porn title. They must not, in small lettering.
Oh, no, I didn't see
must
that.
Must not listen to this podcast.
Yeah, I cut it out somewhere, but you
Look, I think it makes me cruel, but if I would like, I mean, I was very flattered that they put this podcast on their summer must list, and they only did one podcast, and it was our podcast, but I would still much rather watch the not list. I'd rather read that article of here's all the shows you must miss this season, here's all the here's the music to ignore. But I'm sorry. What was your car-related question? And again, thanks for spreading the wealth.
Yeah, I'm looking to buy a new car, and I was looking at the Mini Cooper S. And I know you and Danica Patrick, I think, were talking about it.
Yes.
And gave some pretty good reviews.
Yes.
But I'm a tall guy, and I work as a nurse, so it's kind of a female-oriented profession. And they say that it's a chick car, and it's not a car for tall guys. And I've test-driven it, and I really like it. Mm-hmm. I'm seeing what you think about the stereotype of it.
Okay, couple things. The size of the exterior of the car and the size of the interior car, two different things oftentimes. Yeah. I, T, you'd enjoy this. I'd mentioned a few podcasts ago that I drove recently the new Prius from Beverly Hills to Santa Barbara on less than 2 gallons of gas. They drained the car, they put in 2 gallons of gas, and I made it from the Santa Monica Pier from Beverly Hills to the Santa Monica Pier and then to the pier in Santa Barbara and less than 2 gallons of gas. That car, which is a small car, considered a small car, is very spacious inside, tons of headroom. And my Mini, the exact same way. As a matter of fact, I have a 1999 Jag XK, or I should say XJR, which is much smaller, Donnie backed me up, much smaller headroom-wise inside than the Mini is. So just because it's called a Mini and just because it seems like it's very small from the outside doesn't mean that it's not spacious inside. I'm 6'2", and I had plenty of headroom inside that car. So
you drove the Mini all the time.
I sold it to Donnie, but before that, I drove the Mini all the time. So, A, I love that about the Mini. B, it's a safe car, even though it's a small car. C, man, you really forget the difference between driving a small car and a larger car when it comes to parking, parallel parking, hooking a quick U-turn, maneuvering in and out of traffic. It makes a huge difference. The car is very nimble, and even though it's not a ton of horsepower, it is a ton of fun. And sometimes there's just the certain intangible, the je ne sais quoi. I don't know why. It's like a girl that's really cute.
Yeah, she has an ineffable quality that you can't explain, but when you see her, you like her.
She's not tall. She's not blonde. She's not a beauty. She's not bosomy. She's not anything. It's
Thank
just,
you.
But it all, no, but
still.
No, here's how you know I'm not talking about you. It all comes together. No, it all works when you see the person. We went, there were plenty of girls I went to high school with that I just had crushes on, and they weren't tall, they weren't anything. It's just, it all sort of came together.
Yeah, more than the, or is it
some
more
of their parts, right. And that's what I believe the Mini is, and also reasonably priced and so on and so forth. Now, as far as the gay part goes.
Yeah, is it girly?
The girl. It is one of the only cars that can simultaneously be macho and gay, which is to say, if you get the, they have a peach colored one. If you get the peach colored one and you get it in a convertible and you don't get the S version of it, that is essentially like driving a gay bar. That is a gay bar on wheels. I saw that, by the way, I saw a peach colored mini convertible non-S with the gay flag sticker on it. And I thought to myself, Why are you doing? I can get in the Goodyear blimp and fly over Wilshire Boulevard and see who's gay. I can see from fucking outer space that you're gay. You don't have to put a gay sticker on your. You have a gay sticker. It's a 3,000-pound automobile. You don't.
Well, I came with it. The flag, it was an option, it was like a standard option that came with it.
Well, actually, they probably should, because Mini will do that thing where they'll put a checkerboard on the roof, or they'll put the. They'll put the Union Jack on there.
Right.
How about just the gay flag should just come on all the peach ones?
So if he avoids peach.
Now, you could do the one I did. I hate to use myself as an example, but I got mine in sort of a gunmetal gray with a black roof and black mirrors, and I got the S version, and that car is a straight-looking version of the Mini. So to me, it's the color, and it's the S versus the naturally aspirated versions. Naturally aspirated means non-turbocharged or non-supercharged. So, big endorsement for the Mini. Go for the S and get it in a straight color.
All right, thanks a lot. Do you guys mind if I ask you one more question?
Yes, and by the way, the thing that makes people think you're gay is not your car, it's the crazy nurse shoes you wear.
Do you wear the Crocs?
No, I wear just the black old school Adidas All-Stars.
Oh, really?
Yeah, no, yeah. That's a good solution.
I love the idea of a nurse in normal shoes.
Yeah.
Never seen that before.
Do you have a specialty as a nurse? Do you treat kids or old people?
No. I work on telemetry, so people who have heart attacks, I take care of those guys.
Oh.
All right. That's what telemetry is?
Yeah, it's cardiac monitoring. So so they go into like VTAC or VFib, then we're there to catch it. And
Do you literally hit them with the paddles?
Well, we put the paddles you don't really use anymore because you got to apply so much pressure and you got to put them at a funny angle. So you don't use the paddles anymore. We more use the stickers that you see.
Oh, okay.
It's easier, but yeah, we actually do that.
Do you get to yell clear?
What?
Do you yell clear? Because that's the best part.
Yeah.
Actually, yeah, you do. You put your hand over the patient. You go, everyone's clear, everyone's clear. Because you can actually give someone else a heart attack if you hit them.
The clear and the stat are really the two perks of working in the medical field.
Yeah.
I need the crash cart stat, and then when the crash cart comes, you yell clear.
Clear.
All right. You had a second question?
Yeah, how come you guys don't play your Mexican accordion music game anymore?
Ranchero Countdown?
Yeah, exactly.
I think we'll do that. Sure, why not?
All right, thank you.
We'll start incorporating that into the show. A lot of folks don't know, remember Ranchero Countdown, but you pick a random ranchero song and take bets on how long it takes for the accordion to kick in. You jump in any place in the song. It's usually, Drew and I used to find it was about 3.2 seconds.
Hilarity ensued.
Yeah. And by the way, the accordion is, you know, a tough instrument to sound good on its own, but what the rancheros do to it is basically... essentially, it's like if an accordion got AIDS and then got backed over by a flatbed truck filled with drunken monkeys. It's essentially what they make the accordion sound like.
You get strangled on Tua Gotti style.
Yes, it is the worst fucking sounding music on the planet, played by evidently the drunkest people on the planet for the dumbest people on the planet. That's ranchero music. Anyway, another question, or should we go back to our scintillating conversation?
We got one more question, actually.
All right.
From Andrew.
Andrew.
Hey, how you doing?
What's happening, Andrew?
Oh, not much. I got a question for you, Adam.
Sure.
What do you think your overall percentage was for sniffing out bogus Loveline calls?
Well, you never know, because it's sort of like one of those guys who says, I can always tell when there's a gay guy in the room, or I can always tell when a guy's wearing a bad rug. Well, of course, we put the word bad in front of it, but somehow Jeremy Piven grows more hair each episode of Entourage, and I don't notice it.
Right, I know. Pete Sampras, same thing.
Pete Sampras keeps growing more hair, too. So when something is done right, I don't know. So you say you can pick out all the gays, but what about the ones you aren't picking out that you're not counting as the ones you've picked out? It sort of happens this way. It's sort of the DEA works this way. It's sort of like, hey, we stopped the biggest shipment of cocaine in history from coming in.
That you know about.
Right. Well, that A, that you know about, but that B, that means people are just shipping massive quantities of cocaine. And what about the two ships you missed that were behind the one you stopped? So I never know. I wouldn't claim to, but I would say between Drew and myself, I felt pretty good at it. Although, like I said, nobody ever calls you back and said, by the way, that was a bogus call, so go ahead and remove that one or put that as a strike on your record. That said, I'd still say we're 90%, because usually at some point on a bogus call, you would let us know it was a bogus call, thus the whole motivation for the bogus call.
There have to be revealed at the end.
Yeah, and we usually didn't get too many reveals. We didn't get busted too badly. All right, let's get back to us. Bald Brian.
So, Adam, question for you.
Yes.
You were the first person I saw as a married man.
Yes.
Saw you coming into the reception or into the ceremony late. What was the explanation for that? When they found out why you were moments late?
I blame my wife, of course. And I don't know, you guys tell me how you feel about this. We arrived in plenty of time to make your wedding.
To make the reception, yes.
Well, we arrived two hours before your actual wedding time. Two things.
Oh, I see. Okay.
I don't know. I mean, arrived
initially in
wine country.
Yeah.
I don't know how it works. If someone is getting married and it says 6 o'clock. No one seems to know if that means 6 sharp or 7 o'clock, right, or you should be there at 6, or their actual ceremony is going to happen at 6. And I'll tell you what I'm done with as a husband. I'm done with wearing a jock strap and a fucking bra. I'm going to pay for the goddamn plane tickets. I'm going to pay for the goddamn town car that takes us from the Oakland airport to wine country. I'm going to pay for the goddamn hotel room. I'm going to pay for the goddamn high heels and dress that Lynette's wearing. And then, sweetie, it's up to you. And when she turns to me and says, does 6 o'clock mean I'm not hella fucking wheeze. I'm a goddamn carpenter comedian from the fucking valley. And I've said it a million times to my wife. I'm a fucking guy who got a 1.4 GPA at North Hollywood High, played football, went to Valley College, got thrown out of Valley College, and then cleaned fucking carpets for a living, and then became a comedian. I'm not in fucking charge of when we should. You figure that out. And Lynette's thing is like, all right, and then that's it. But my thing is like, I get in a thing where I'm going like, come on, honey, we should really be going. And then I'm thinking, what the fuck am I that guy for? Like, why, what happened? I mean, T, stop me if you disagree. Look, if you're working and you're bringing home the bacon and you're up fucking mending the roof or troubleshooting the electrical system in the house or doing all that shit, then fine, let him do half his shit. But my feeling is, listen, ladies, it's a wedding. You should be the one who's coming and saying to me, come on, let's go. We're going to be late. You're supposed to get to
right,
these things by whatever.
To pick out the wedding gift, to send a card from you, all that stuff.
Right. which she did, but we were sort of sitting around the room, and I was sort of going, it's 6:20, and she, you know, I could hear the hairdryer going in the bathroom, going, how does this work? And she's going, well, they normally start a little whatever. So my feeling is, like, I don't want to be the guy who, like I said, underwrites everything and then goes, come on, come on, come on, we got to get going, you know, come on, get you, which I always do, and which I do a lot. What the problem is, chicks take 45 fucking minutes to get dressed versus 6 minutes to get dressed. I mean, I don't even brush my hair. If I shaved that morning, I am under 3 minutes to literally get dressed. So all I can do, I was watching Charlie's Angels, by the way. Yeah. All I can do is sit on the fucking foot of the bed in my underpants watching Charlie's Angels, waiting for the sound of the hairdryer to stop to signal me to pull up my trousers.
It wasn't not Charlie's Angels. It was right. Actually Charlie's Angels.
I wish it
Angels.
Was not Charlie's Angels.
Well, I figured they weren't coming because I didn't see them during the ceremony. I was looking around. And then, of course, right after the ceremony, we saw them walking up. And then Lynette was put in a very awkward position because what? Just moments after the ceremony, there was, like, you know, cocktails yes. and mingling. And we
How
were
was
standing
that
there.
Like, that's what part of mass was cocktail hour.
Cocktail hour was great.
Yeah. Yeah.
Good appetizers. It was beautiful
yeah.
out.
Sliders.
And,
yeah.
Yeah, sliders. And so we were sitting and standing and mingling. And, of course, everyone wants to come talk to Lynette because everyone does love Lynette. And you know, we were mingling. And, of course, what do you talk about right after a wedding ceremony? Yeah. The ceremony.
Sure.
So I was standing with Lynette and people kept coming up going, wasn't it a beautiful ceremony? Now, she's just missed it. What's
sure.
she supposed to do? Go on a long explanation right. about how. So, of course, she was like, it was so beautiful.
We walked from our bungalow up a sort of incline made of grass and literally bumped into Christy and Brian.
Yeah.
They just got done.
And then I had
kind
of given her a few details of the ceremony just in case. So she'd be able to engage.
Listen, please. Stop me if I'm out of line here, men. What the fuck? When did it become our job to, like I said, you know, pay the mortgage, keep the lights on the house, pay for every fucking thing, and be the one who, like, becomes the nudge? Come on, sweetie, it's late. Come on, honey, that's the chick job, is it not?
I don't know. I remember my grandfather always being in the car honking for my grandma, who was always last out, and yelling, get the lead out.
I've had it happen 1,000 times with 1,000 different venues, events, whatever, where I'm the one who's going, like, come on, let's move on. And it's like, I want to be on the fucking sofa with a beer watching SportsCenter and have her come in fully dressed going, hey, what the fuck? Come on, let's go. We're going to be late. Not me going, come on, come on, come on. And then it's just weird. You become this nudge, you know, like, come on, when are you, come on, when are we going? And then also, as far as, well, first off, I don't, you know, I'm the kind of, I traveled, you know, 500 miles and then missed the thing by 10 minutes. But, you know, Donnie and I went and saw the 24 hours of Le Mans, and we traveled to France and caught the last 10 minutes of the race.
Oh, no.
I swear
really?
To God. Well, they started it an hour. They started it and they finished it an hour early this one year. And there was, and it was raining. So there's like some rain issues and our train, and we missed our train because our conductor fucked us up. But I'm the guy who literally, forget about going to wine country. I literally went to France to watch a 24-hour race and caught the last 18 minutes of it. Donnie, am I lying?
You're telling the truth. But amazingly enough, though, when we went there, the team we went to go see won.
The Aston Martin team
and
won.
Won.
So we
like
were standing
40 or 50 years.
They won for 50 years. We're standing in the pit of the winning team, so we can nice. Enjoy that.
Yeah, that's nice.
But I had to put on the same face that Lynette put on.
Oh, it was
awesome.
Amazing
race. Awesome.
24 hours.
Amazing.
Wow, 24. That ceremony was incredible.
So I blame it on my wife, and my feeling is I'm going to stand by it. It's a constant burr in my saddle, this sort of blurring of the lines of what the sexes are in charge of. I don't feel like in a relationship, I don't feel like the guy shit has changed much. Now, it's true they don't fight as well as they used to, and it's true they don't fix a car as well as they used to. But I've said many, many times, I make the money, and I fix the house, and I pay for everything. I'm not going to be the one pushing everyone to get out of the house to go to whatever the event is. And then also, like I said, I don't know what the rule is. If it starts at 6, What time did you guys actually get started? About 6:20?
Yeah, no, pretty close to 6, actually, I think.
It's maybe a little late.
I wasn't wearing a watch, but yeah.
You got to start. I mean, if you're saying start at 6, I don't know. Would it kill? Not blaming you. Not blaming you.
Thank you.
But would it kill people to say, you know, ceremony sharp. Starts at 6 sharp or arrive at 5:30 right. or something that kind of? Or put. I think the sharp versus the soft opening. I think that's it.
Because I know I'm not hella fucking wheeze. I mean, I'm really not. Like, right. I was raised by wolves, and I don't know anything about etiquette. I always double check. So I think I double checked with their wedding planner. Hmm. Do you mean 6 or do you mean 6:30? Because it was so hot out there, no one wanted to get there early. But I know my limitations, and I did check. So we made it. But do you and by the way, I know what you mean about not wanting to wear the bra and the jock strap. I don't think anyone wants that. Women don't want that. Men don't want that. No one wants to have to do
it. It's not attractive quality.
It's not.
Right.
Are you the one that hurries up Christy?
A little bit. But I mean, I feel like we do a fair amount of... we're both sort of very conscious of what's going on around us, so we don't have to hurry each other up too much.
And during the ceremony that Adam missed...
Yes.
How was it?
It was good. I was obsessed with not falling over. That was my number one goal, was not stumbling. But it worked out okay. I wore wide shoes, and... I dulled up my steroids, so I was able to knock down my symptoms a little bit. It was it was hot.
It was so I felt for you because it was warm. It was what around 100,
yeah.
And you had to wear a wool
tux, yeah.
Yeah,
but it was
unseasonably
yeah.
hot.
Yeah, normally it's around 85. It's probably 100.
I'd say it could have cracked 100.
Yeah,
it did.
I mean, sure. even at 6:30 in the evening, it was hotter and shit. I was someone's car alarm's going off outside. Well, that's probably a good enough sign to wrap it up anyway.
By the way, your wedding planner, Teresa, is the same as my wedding planner, Michelle Buckley of Mint Julep Social Events, MJSE.com. If you're out there planning an event, look her up.
Yeah, give a plug.
Yeah.
All right, T, why don't you give your plug for your website?
ExploitingMyBaby.com.
Bald Brian.
You can find me at HiBrian.com, and if I Christy blog, which we always reference, that at InConvenientTumor.com.
We're also looking at ways to do a fundraising event for Christy and Brian as well.
Yeah, let's do that. We've been talking about it for a long time.
And
You know what I was going to do?
Yeah.
Whenever we figure this out, I was going to actually auction off the shaving of my mustache.
Ooh.
And donate the proceeds to you, Brian.
That'd be good for a nickel.
Huge. Thanks, Donnie. You guys are a real good guy.
Okay. Either way, we'll figure it out. We'll do a podcast. We'll do a fundraiser. We'll do a telethon. Whatever it is, we'll do a live event. You guys who are all listening will be included in on this, and it'll obviously go to a very worthy cause. We'll keep you posted on that. So, until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Teresa Strasser and dear friend Bald Brian, and of course, my buddy the Wheeze, saying mahalo. Rasta-rana,
do it again. You can follow Adam Carolla on Twitter at Adam Carolla. Reach him via Skype at Adam Podcast or at 10061 Riverside Drive, number 267, Toluca Lake, California, 91602.